So I was 34 years old. I was sitting at home minding my own business. And the phone rang. It was an old friend of mine by the name of Craig Strickland. He's obviously much, much older, but no, man, don't tell him I said that. He's a year older than me. He had just planted a church in the month before in a restaurant here in Cordova. And he called and he said, hey, I was just wondering, when are you and Patty coming out to visit the church? And I said, well, Craig, we have a church, and I've been there for 34 years. But I promise you, we'll get out to see you guys as soon as we can. I hung up the phone, looked at Patty, and said, that's the saddest thing I've heard in a long time. That was Craig, and he was basically saying, for the love of God, please come out here and see the church. I said, Patty, we need to get out there, or we may lose a friend in this deal, and we better go quickly, because I don't know how long this thing might last. So on Thanksgiving weekend in November of 1988, Patty and I and the three kids piled into our little Nissan Stanza wagon and drove out to the Shelby Place restaurant to see what this Hope Presbyterian Church was all about. By the way, after that Sunday, we never went back to my home church. Pretty soon, Craig began to lay the groundwork of me joining him on the staff. And when I say staff, Craig was asking me to join him and his administrative assistant. That was the staff. At the time, I was the urban director for Memphis Young Life. I had spent 11 years on Young Life staff, and I loved my job. But I was intrigued. I was intrigued because Hope was doing church very differently in those days. Craig was calling Hope a church for unchurched people. And I was very drawn to that idea, that there could be a place where an unchurched person might be able to come in and kick the tires of the faith, if you will. But I told Craig right off the bat that if Hope wasn't going to be involved in the city and the needs of our city, that I wouldn't be happy and he wouldn't be happy with me. I knew that I did not want to be part of a church that was so provincial that all it cared about were the saved and sanctified in our building. God love them, and God thank you for them. But I longed to be a part of a place that also cared about the neighborhood and the city in which we live. And so that's what we've tried to be, and we've made way, way, way more mistakes than most churches have. In fact, I was trying to convince our communication folks that we ought to print up a t-shirt for our anniversary that says, Hope Church, 30 years of trying not to screw everything up. They were actually looking for something a little more positive. But I love this passage in Philippians 2 that we are all so familiar with. I've always read this passage in a personal way, with me as an individual in mind. But I ask you today to hear this passage as a corporate call to the church. Paul writes, therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, if there is any consolation of love, if there is any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and compassion, make my joy complete by being of the same mind, church, maintaining the same love, church, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, church, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, church, but also for the interest of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. I'll never forget, my son came back from a church camp, in the summer jam or something, years ago, and he had on the front of his shirt, he was like 15, get an attitude. I'm saying, perfect. I sent that dude to church camp, and this is the shirt he gets. And on the back was, have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. How can we as churches live Philippians 2 lives? Because see, it's so easy not to. We feel such pressure to keep our theology pure and our budgets on point and our faithful members fed and encouraged. And all those are good things. In fact, no, they are all great things. But see, here's the question I think we need to always ask ourselves. Not do we have the strength, or do we have the numbers, or do we have the theology, but do we have the humility? Do we have the humility to be the hands and feet of Christ in our communities? Can we serve? Now, can we serve not just the wonderful Christian organizations in town that we support? Can we serve the town? Can we offer ourselves to do the dirty work in our communities? Can we go to the public schools in our neighborhood and say, what can we do? And be prepared for the worst. Well, I tell you what we need. We need lunchroom monitors. Oh, Lord. We also need volunteers to meet the buses at 7 a.m. to make sure the kids get in safely. Can we go to the park commission in our neighborhood and say, what can we do? And be prepared. You know, these ball fields are unkept and dangerous. Can you help us keep them up this summer? Or they say, our seniors meet in the community center every Thursday from 10 to noon. Man, our budget is strapped and we don't have the staff to tend to them. They love bingo, they love playing cards, they love karaoke, and they love coffee. Can we do that? Because you see, in our world today, I think that's part of our call. And when people ask, what do those things have to do with the gospel? I generally tell them that is the gospel. The Savior said the greatest commandment is this: love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. And the second is like it: love your neighbor as you love yourself. And we all remember the question that followed, right? Who is my neighbor? And Jesus tells this powerful story of the most unlikely of neighbors. Are we ready to be that sort of church? Because see, in this post-Christian culture, I'm afraid that's the sort of church who has the greatest opportunity to have a voice, a humble, Christ-centered servant body. Like I said, we've messed it up more than we've done it right. But even so, that does not change the mandate, does it? Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interest, but also for the interest of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. Get an attitude. Personally and corporately, get that attitude. Let's pray together. Father, we adore you. We're humbled that you call us your children. And we pray that we can begin to live lives, if we're not already, that serve those around us. Father, we'll naturally serve one another because we love each other as the body of Christ. But Father, teach us to reach out and serve others in our community so that they might be able to see a glimpse of Jesus. Just a glimpse of Jesus and what we do and what we say and how we do it and how we say it. Father, may we love the poor. May we love the strangers. May we embrace and stand with them. Father, may we love our schools in our neighborhoods. May we love our community centers. Father, may we encourage our educators. May we encourage our police department and fire department, all that we can do so that your name might be high and lifted up. And when it is, we'll continue to give you all the glory and all the praise, for you are our Lord, we have none other. In the strong name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen.